A great storyboard artist isn't necessarily Michelangelo, isn't necessarily a fabulous animator. What a great storyboard artist is a great communicator. Hi, this is a storyboard drawing, one of the essential tools in the making of an animated film. Storyboards allow the filmmakers to see a blueprint of the movie before we go into actual animation production. Walt Disney developed the use of storyboards way back in the 1920s for his classic Mickey Mouse cartoon, Steamboat Willie. Storyboards are like little comic book panels of the entire movie, and they're used by tacking them up on a bulletin board so you can actually see the continuity of the movie. You can see the rough staging and camera positions. You can see the acting of the characters. The dialogue is written underneath. In animation, storyboarding has always been and is still used mainly to develop the story.
Now in our studio, we don't write our stories. We draw them.
Storyboards, being an effective and very inexpensive way of developing the content for the movie, gave Disney the opportunity to board up something and see if it worked before expensive animation took place.
You start off and you start visualizing it like a comic strip, kind of. You work out the business and you develop it that way. And then you look at it and you go, is this working? Is this funny? Is this dramatic? What can we change? So this is why we work like this, because these things can be changed so quickly, you know? They're on, they're off. And you can move things around and see how things play.
A great storyboard artist can put down on a storyboard the minimum amount of information necessary to get a very dynamic and quick read on the content and the emotions in the sequence.
When you're actually drawing the story sketches, you get emotional about them yourself, and so you're looking for things that have a lot of heart, and you are trying to draw that in a very simple way to express what you're feeling. That's great story sketching.
Hitchcock said, storyboard artist has to be a good storyteller. It isn't enough to just make a beautiful drawing. The drawing has to have the meaning and the feelings of what you were trying to say.
Usually, if you have a good storyboard artist, he's also a good pitch artist as well.
When you're pitching a board, you do all the parts and everything. You take on the characters, you change your voice, and you'd even add effects. You know, you take on a woman's voice, the old man's voice, or whatever it was. And it was very harrowing when you'd bring Walt into the room, because he could pitch better than anybody. Once he's got rolling, he would get excited, he would act it out, and you sat there mesmerized by Walt's storytelling. That was Walt's great ability.
A storyboard pitch is one of the great performance arts that was developed in this century at Disney's, and no one ever gets to see it.
The next step after you've shown your board, it's been okayed, everybody loves it, let's put it on a story reel.
Those storyboards are taken and shot on film and timed to a rough soundtrack. So you can actually see the movie playing in real time before any animation takes place.
Walt Disney invented the idea of making these story reels, telling the story in a simple form before you enter the more complex form. It was, at the time, I think, incredibly innovative, as most of what Walt Disney had done.
Often storyboard artists are noted for putting in business, putting in interesting things for the characters to do.
Every artist usually winds up having something that they really excel at, you know, whether it be the emotional end of it or whether they are for the chases. Willie Reitherman, he was the expert on chases.
You definitely cast storyboard artists according to what their strengths are. Some storyboard artists are really comic artists, and they will concentrate on the humor. Other artists are much more cinematic, and you would use them for action scenes.
Walt was very smart. He cast the story people who he thought were going to be the best ones on that particular sequence.
Soon, a lot of Hollywood was noticing how good Walt Disney's movies were, and the use of storyboards was a large part of that. Over the years, this process was adopted by Disney's live-action directors. And now, storyboards are used on almost every live-action production around the world.
There are so many people involved in the motion picture making process that everybody has to be aware of the central needs of the film. And that's where the storyboard can let everybody in on the secrets.
If I can make things work on paper, then I can make them work on the set. And if I can create a visual style on paper, I can absolutely create it on God's green earth.
I worked with Jeffrey Katzenberg on the Shrek movies, who had really read everything that Walt Disney had ever written about filmmaking. So I was very lucky to learn Walt Disney's technique of using the storyboards as a writing storytelling tool. In The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, I storyboarded the whole film so I could actually watch the movie before I started shooting it. In order to convince people to give me the time to storyboard the whole movie ahead of time, I said, look, this is an expensive writing tool, but a really inexpensive production tool.
The storyboard indicates what you will see on the screen and also indicate what you don't need to spend money on. The storyboard can cut out a lot of unnecessary work.
My attachment to storyboards is I act and direct.
Boom.
And I like to kind of be able to take the pressure off myself by anticipating how I'm going to shoot something. And then I can sense new opportunities on the set that could not have been necessarily anticipated in a room where I was drawing with an artist.
When a storyboard artist works with a director on a film, it's kind of like he's been given a portion of the pie. What the storyboard artist gets to do is add a lot of his own touches to the material.
Storyboards are a great way to keep everyone on the page. And creatively, it's a great way to start creating and visualizing the movie itself.
All right, well, let's turn this thing around.
I had a lot of fun with Mick Reinman coming up with ways to visualize this story. And we would sit around in my barn and we would come up with different things. Hey, what about this ladybug? We'll have the power hitter, Ted Ray's getting ready to just hit this massive drive. And what if a ladybug drops down the ball and it becomes like a drama about the ladybug? And so we had a lot of fun laying all that out.
My first day on the film Saboteur, it was my first real contact with Hitchcock. I was on one side of the desk, he was on the other. And he would make his little drawings. And then I would make some on the same sequence. I think Hitchcock was really testing me.
What I try to do is start off with the scenes where I really maybe want to establish my film language. Maybe on the first scene, take them through step by step. Like I want a big horizon shot, and then I want, you know, a wagon coming from right to left. But then I'll let them do all the scenes after that by themselves, because I would rather have the benefit in this collaborative atmosphere to have him think of an idea that I never would have thought of.
Well, I started with a script, and in the script I would make very rough drawings. Then I would go to Hitchcock, and we would discuss the various sequences and see if my thoughts were anything near like his.
In live action, the use of storyboarding really kind of evolved into a tool for staging, so they know where they have to set the cameras, what the special effects might be.
If there were difficult passages, take a film like The Birds, in which we had to get these little flying creatures into almost every shot, we needed a storyboard of practically the whole film. And also in a very complex film like Saboteur. Saboteur needed a lot of drawing so that everybody knew what our problems were.
Quite often when we're about to shoot a scene, we'll actually start by pinning up all the storyboards. It's often a useful tool to communicate to your art directors, the set designers, you know, sometimes the actors, kind of this is what the scene is doing, and really block out the scene using the storyboards as a point of reference.
The notion that a picture's worth a thousand words, it really comes into play when you're dealing with storyboards, because I can really get eight people behind me and I can point and everybody can suddenly be on the same page.
With a lot of big sequences in live action, with battles and so on, you'll have three or four units shooting at once. So those storyboards become a tool to communicate to them. You give them to your second unit director, say, I need this shot, this shot, this shot.
Open Range, for instance, there's the final shootout sequence, which is about 12 days on a schedule. And 9 out of those 12 days, I had to go to cover sets because we were experiencing weather changes. We needed the light that we started the sequence in to be the light that we ended it in. So the storyboard saved me. When we actually were going to come back to that sequence, which was very elaborate, everybody knew what we were going to be coming back to. There was going to be no guesswork. And so I find them my greatest tool, actually, the storyboard.
Live-action directors use storyboards for a variety of purposes in the filmmaking process. But in animation, storyboards have always been and are still used to develop the story and the characters. Walt Disney was a great story developer and a great story editor. If he saw a sequence on boards that he didn't think was working, it would come out of the movie and a new one would be developed.
So you throw the whole thing out and you start from scratch and you'd get all excited again and start building it up. I think a great storyboard artist has that ability to get excited after it's been shot down and move on and build the excitement over again.
The amount of time spent on developing a Disney film was often decades. There are early versions in the 1930s of storyboards for Alice in Wonderland, storyboards for Peter Pan, even though those movies didn't come out until the 1950s. For Lady and the Tramp, Joe Grant actually pitched the idea to Walt in 1937, and active storyboard development didn't take place until 43. The movie itself came out in 55. So you can see almost a 20-year period there of developing what actually got into Lady and the Tramp.
If we boarded a version and it wasn't quite working, Walt would say, well, let's not follow this version, let's start another version. Every drawing you got thrown out. It didn't matter because out of the whole thing, what they were suggesting was it going to be better. We would have the storyboard shot with the still camera, and we would make an 8x10 negative. So every storyboard was recorded. And then the individual sketches would be taken off the storyboard and then they'd be filed away.
Walt Disney, in the purest sense, was an artist. But he also had that idiosyncrasy of an artist who just throws his great work away because in some way it doesn't match up. But listen, every cartoon is still measured against Walt Disney. He knew the difference. And I would trust him. I would trust him. And we do trust him. We trust him with our children.